Welcome, I'm James Foster, and I'm going to talk about the Alkire Foster methodology. A number can awaken consciences, and it can do many other things too, according to Miguel Sekely. We, many of us, believe in the power of measurement. That's what this lecture is all about. We begin with unidimensional technologies, the main one being the Foster-Greer-Thorbeck measure, which has been used in a number of places. The unidimensional approach takes income as its variable, typically, has a cutoff called the poverty line to determine those below the poverty line as being poor, that's the identification part, and then aggregation, where you combine all the data into a measure. Let's have examples here. Income 7348, poverty line is 5. The first measure of the FGT class is given by the headcount ratio. Construct, and look at this carefully, for everyone who happens to be below the poverty line, put a 1 in their place. Others put 0. That's the so-called deprivation vector. Take a mean of that deprivation vector and you obtain the headcount ratio. 2 out of 4 people are poor. If you are interested in getting into information on the depth of poverty, then perhaps a normalized gap vector would be helpful. It takes the poverty line minus the income and puts it over the poverty line to look at a kind of percentage shortfall from the poverty line that a person has. Take a look at person 2 and see if it matches up with your intuition. Now, once you have done this for each poor person and then looked at zeros for each non-poor person, average it up, you get the so-called poverty gap measure. In this case, it's 3 out of 20. Now, that measure doesn't differentiate between people with really extremely poor or low levels of income and people who are not so poor, in the sense that they average everything up at the end of the day. The squared gap vector squares the normalized gaps from the previous vector so as to emphasize the poorest of the poor. Take a look at the person with 2/5 in the normalized vector. Now it's 4/25. 1/5 becomes 1/25. The ratio goes from 2:1 to 4:1, emphasizing the really poor person. Average up that vector and you obtain the FGT measure. That measure is sensitive to inequality, and it's particularly sensitive to the very poor persons. Now let's get into the Alkire Foster methodology. We begin with multidimensional data, a matrix of data of n people in d dimensions. You might imagine this in an Excel file. The first column here is like dollars a day. Second is years of schooling. Third is a ordinal variable, self-reported health, which really doesn't have any numbers attached to it, just categories. Excellent, very good, good, fair, poor. Correspond to 5 all the way down to 1. But we put the numbers in because it's easy. Finally, we have access to social services, with a 1 indicating you have that access, 0 means you don't. Who's deprived in each one of these dimensions? Well, we need to find some way of thinking about a cutoff there, a deprivation cutoff, I might call it, and that's given in Z. So $13 a day, 12 years of schooling, category 3, which is good, and the two below it are fair and poor. And finally, not having access to social service. So if you look below 1, the only thing left is 0, and that indicates that you're deprived. So we can determine who the heck is deprived here on the next slide. I underline those people who are deprived in a given dimension. 1 if deprived, 0 if not deprived, will now be replaced in this matrix to obtain something similar to the deprivation vector we had before, except now it's called a deprivation matrix. In this case where dimensions have equal weight, notice I haven't put higher numbers in the space for one dimension versus another. However, if weights differ, then you would have a vector of weights, one for each dimension, and they may differ. In this case, you would have replaced the ones with the actual differentiated weights and you would have obtained a weighted deprivation matrix. Now, if we have equal weights, then the two matrices are the same anyway. So let's assume that we have equal weights. Weights 1, 1, 1, 1, equal weights for each dimension. Now let's decide who might be poor. Identification approach that we use here is called the dual cutoff approach. We answer the question who's poor by counting up the deprivations found, and then we compare it with an overall second type of cutoff. Call it K. This poverty cutoff, if you will, is such that if you have a count which is greater than or equal to what's necessary to be poor, you're considered to be poor. Let's take, for example, K equals 2. It's a popular example. Who is poor in this case? Think about it. Not the first person, not the fourth person, but the two middle people, as indicated by the lines drawn underneath. Other examples would give you different outcomes as to who would be considered to be poor. In this case, if I started with K equals 1, we would have what's called union identification, where any deprivation implies you're poor. Alternatively, if you had K equals 4, that would be where all four dimensions would have to be deprivations in order to be considered to be poor. Now, we won't focus on those two cases, but instead we'll look at something intermediate. Given an intermediate poverty cutoff, how much poverty overall is there? This idea is called aggregation, creating a measure. And the first step in our approach is to censor the entries of those people who are non-poor. Remember, person 4 had a deprivation in education, but that person isn't poor. So we remove that deprivation and are left with only the deprivations of the poor folks. This results in what's called the censored weighted deprivation matrix. But why not just count the share of the people who are poor, the headcount ratio? 2 out of 4, that's easy, 1/2, we're done. But what happens if a poor person becomes more deprived in the sense that a new deprivation pops up? For example, person 2 here now is deprived in income, although person 2 wasn't before. Of course, the count goes up to 3 from 2, but this is not reflected. You still have only 2 out of 4 folks who are poor. This violates a property called dimensional monotonicity. In order to satisfy that property, you need to have a measure that considers additional information. Now, what information? Let's augment the information given in the headcount ratio by the following information on the deprivation shares among the poor, in fact, the average deprivation share. Person 2 has 2 out of 4, person 3 has 4 out of 4, the average is 3 out of 4. Hence, A, the average deprivation share among the poor, is 3/4. This can also be called the intensity of poverty. Multiplying the headcount ratio by the intensity measure, the average deprivation share, gives you the overall adjusted headcount ratio. That's our measure. That's how we measure poverty in this world. So look at it here. We had 1/2 times 3/4. That's equal to 3/8, or 0.375. A second way of calculating the measure is to just take the sum of all the entries in the matrix and then divide by the number of entries. So in this case, it's 6 divided by 16. Once again, 3/8, or 0.375. Two equivalent ways of getting to the final number of the adjusted headcount ratio. Now let's take that same situation where person 2 gains a deprivation. What happens? The person's deprivation share goes up to 3/4 from 2/4. As a result, the average goes up to 7/8, increasing M0. Therefore, it satisfies dimensional monotonicity. So what about the Alkire Foster methodology? What can we say about it? First, it's rather intuitive. It conveys information on multiple deprivations and combines them together, first identifying who is multiply deprived and then averaging up kind of the societal poor deprivations. Second, it's easy to compute. It's a mean of a matrix, for goodness sake. That's pretty straightforward. It's applicable and expandable, applicable to ordinal data like the self-reported health. And if you wanted to get only cardinal information, such as income or other measures you consider to be reasonable, you could apply our alternative measures in the paper where this original AF methodology came out. It also exhibits useful properties, such as dimensional monotonicity we've been talking about, but also two really important disaggregation properties across groups of people and across dimensions or variables. Let's take a look at the subgroup disaggregation, or as it's called, subgroup decomposability. You have a total population separated into one group and another group. We can look then at M0 for the whole group and for each group separately. Let's do that. For the whole group, 3/8. For each group, 2/8. For the yellow group, for the blue group, 4/8. Add up, 2/8, 4/8, with weights on them of 1/2, that's the population share. Then you get 1/8 plus 2/8 equals 3/8. It works. Therefore, this measure satisfies subgroup decomposability, whereby the overall poverty is a population share weighted average of the individual poverty levels. What's subgroup 1's percentage contribution? Well, divide through by the total poverty. Okay? Divide what? Divide the weight. Divide the 1/8, which was the weight times its own M0. And you will have 1/8 divided by 3/8, which is 1/3, or 33%. That's the contribution of group 1. The other group is naturally 2/3, or 66%. We can also disaggregate by dimensions. The four dimensions, J equals 1 through 4, I've indicated in different colors. And if you look at what's going on in the first column, we see that 1 out of 4 persons is both deprived in the first dimension and poor. So 1/4 is what the censored headcount ratio is. Again, that's the share of the population that's both poor and deprived in a particular dimension. For the second, it's 2/4. For the third, it's 1/4. And for the fourth, 2/4 again. If you aggregate those up, add them up with weights, since everything is equally weighted here, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, 1/4, you obtain 1/4 by looking at WI, putting it over the total, which is 4. That's the number of dimensions, 4. So 1/4 times the censored headcount ratio for the first dimension, for the second, for the third, for the fourth, added up, and you can see that you obtain the overall poverty measure from the dimensions. So this measure satisfies what's called dimensional breakdown, which allows you to kind of allocate how much of overall poverty is due to different dimensions. Now, divide through by the total amount of poverty. So you take the weight times the censored headcount ratio and divide through by the total amount of poverty, 3/8, and you'll get the percentage contribution of various dimensions. In this case, the first dimension has 16.7%.